Yeah, so co-ops are a general engineering thing all across the country. So what you can do is, it's basically like an apprenticeship at a company. So you interview at the company and you get selected to work at the company for like, I don't know, a semester and a summer. So just about 8 months. And you actually get to work as an engineer in the field. And you get to see if that's what you want to do and what you like about it. And you get paid most of the time. And it's just a really great experience because it kind of is balances out the theoreticalness of the school versus what you're actually going to do. And so it makes sure that you actually want to be an engineer. So I started out doing structural health monitoring of composite pressure vessels. Using non-destructive evaluation techniques. So that is basically like, let's say you're really like fishing and you have your favorite fishing rod and you take it with you on every trip. But now you're going on a big trip to Montana and you want to make sure that your rod isn't going to break because it's pretty old. But you don't want to break your favorite rod to figure out how much strength it has left in it. So you might use certain ways like look inside the material. Like with lasers or with the way it sounds. So we used acoustic emission sensors, which is like little microphones that you glue onto the structure. And if it makes sounds like it's gonna break, then you can take it out of service. After that co-op, I got accepted into their official co-op program and I went down, I did hypervelocity impact testing. So over the last 50 years of space launches from private and commercial and government industry, there's been a lot of debris and trash that's still like in orbit. So once you launch something, you pay an energy debt to get that mass into a stable orbit. And so that includes everything like the paint chips in between the stages and all the circuit boards and all everything. It stays in orbit until it decays, like the orbit decays. And that can take a really long time. So right now there's a bunch of basically space debris, space trash. It's just floating around in the same orbits as all the communication satellites, all the guidance satellites, the International Space Station. And the thing about, even though the particles can be down to a quarter of a diameter of a human hair, up to the size of a rocket body, those really small particles have an immense amount of kinetic energy because they're moving super fast. And so, especially when people's lives are in danger, like if you're in the International Space Station or you're in one of the commercial crew vehicles that are coming up soon, or you're in the space shuttle, all of a sudden knowing how your spacecraft will respond to being impacted by this debris becomes very important. So at NASA in White Sands, at the White Sands Test Facility, they have a huge set of guns that shoots projectiles at 17,500 miles an hour. And we can actually test cross sections of spacecraft shielding to make sure that they can withstand a certain amount of debris size. And then they're also developing ways to protect spacecraft by designing the shielding on the outside to ensure that a certain size of particle will be absorbed by the craft. Then I went on to work at when you build the International Space Station, you have to do a ton of work outside of the pressurized capsule that you're in. So they call that extravehicular activity. So it's basically like spacewalking. It is spacewalking. And it's really different to work in a microgravity environment, especially when it's as harsh as the vacuum of space. You have temperature swings from minus 250 to plus 250, I think it's Fahrenheit. Anyway, so you have like a 500 degree temperature swing, you have the vacuum of space, you have space debris, you have to have a suit that can withstand that environment in order to even go outside. And so that gives you a bulky contraption that you have to be inside while you're working. And so you have to learn how to work with the suit in order to do things outside. So they have a huge pool called the Neutral Buoyancy Lab. It's like 6.3 million gallons of water. It's basically an indoor lake. and it has a full-scale mock-up of the International Space Station in like 40 feet of water. And so they have a bunch of scuba divers, and that's kind of where some of my other extracurricular activities came in from Mizzou, AKA the scuba club. One of the coolest things I did at Johnson Space Center this summer was worked on a project that actually got uplinked to the International Space Station. And I got to sit in the back room of the mission control room as kind of like backup for when they actually did the task that my project was on the space station. So it was really cool to be listening to the loops with the flight director and all the support engineering and talking with the astronaut on station, going Mach 25, 250 miles above the Earth, just all right there. And it just was a culmination of, it was like a dream come true, really, because I, ever since I've been a little kid, I wanted to work at NASA. And just to be that close and connected and doing the things that I always thought I would want to do just was amazing.